top 10 strongest pieces of evidence that Matthew Franklin Whittier, not Edgar Allan Poe, was the real author of The Raven. Number 1. Matthew Franklin Whittier, the younger brother of famous poet John Greenleaf Whittier, began publishing in Boston and New York City newspapers in 1825 at age 12. He wrote poetry, essays, and satirical sketches. He also wrote humorous letters to the editor as though he was a variety of different characters and under a variety of pen names. Beginning in late 1844, he was writing reviews and essays for the New York Tribune on a freelance basis, signing with his longtime secret signature, a star or single printer's asterisk. Historians have mistakenly attributed that body of work to transcendentalist Margaret Fuller, who was the official literary editor of the paper. Edgar Allan Poe was the reviewer for another major New York paper at the time, the Evening Mirror, which was situated very close to the Tribune building. In the December 27, 1844 edition of the Tribune, appeared a poem written by Matthew entitled The Might of Words. It is written in the same style as The Raven, which was, in fact, Matthew's preferred style throughout his career. The first two stanzas read, "What to man his greatness giveth, or the creeping things and birds, but the soul that in him liveth, and the glory of his words? In his voice were blent the rushing of the storm winds o'er the seas, with the fountain's peaceful gushing and the music of the breeze." Note especially that Matthew expresses his deep devotion to God in this poem. "Words are weapons, better, truer, sharper than the battle sword, strong against the evil doer with the server of the Lord." This poem he signed with his first initial, M, from South Attleboro, Massachusetts. South Attleboro is roughly 80 miles south of Matthew's hometown of Haverhill, Massachusetts. Number 2. In the January 16, 1845 edition of the Tribune, in a review of a poetry compilation by Longfellow, Matthew praised a deeply religious poem by Francis Quarles entitled, "Sweet Phosphor, Bring the Day." The following month, The Raven appeared in the February edition of American Review, signed Quarles with a blank line in front, so that it reads, blank line, Quarles. The editor of the review remarked, in his introduction, "The following lines from a correspondent, besides the deep, quaint strain of the sentiment, and the curious introduction of some ludicrous touches amidst the serious and impressive, as was doubtless intended by the author, appear to us one of the most felicitous specimens of unique rhyming which has for some time met our eye." This was precisely Matthew's lifelong style as a humorist. Even in deep grief, he couldn't help but inject some whimsy into the poem. But Edgar Allan Poe, having received an advance copy of American Review as a critic for the Evening Mirror, somehow convinced his editor that he actually had permission to scoop the American Review, and arranged to have the poem published in that paper under his own name. He was able to do that because he already had a copy of the poem, which Matthew appears to have shared with him either in late 1842 or early 1843. Matthew had a reason to sign the poem Blank Quarles. He had long admired the poetry of 17th century English poet Francis Quarles, who wrote austere religious poetry. Matthew, raised Quaker, was a deeply spiritual man. But the antiquarian book in his possession probably had belonged to his true love, Abbey Poyen, who had died a few years earlier. The Raven was a tribute to her. It was probably written within a year after her death, and spoke both of fresh grief and a terrible faith crisis. Perhaps he was reading through Abbey's copy of Quarles' poetry during the incident recounted in The Raven, hoping to strengthen his faith. "Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore." The first instance we have of Matthew's admiration for Quarles comes in September of 1831, when he introduced Quarles' poem, False World, in the Boston-based young men's magazine called The Essayist. That poem begins, "False world, thou liest, thou canst not lend the least delight. Thy favors cannot gain a friend, they are so slight. Thy morning pleasures make an end to please at night. Poor are the wants that thou suppliest, and yet thou vauntest, and yet thou viest with heaven. Fond earth, thou boastest. False world, thou liest." Matthew signed this article, and others in The Essayist, with a variation on his middle name, Franklin Jr. He followed this up with an in-depth essay praising Quarles' poetry in the April 1832 edition. Thus, we know that Matthew, a deeply religious man, much admired the poetry of Francis Quarles, a deeply religious poet. We know that he had access to an original antiquarian volume of Quarles' poetry in 1831, and that he wrote favorably about it and presented examples at that time. We know he praised it again shortly before The Raven was published under the pseudonym Blank Quarles, and we also know that he published a poem in a similar style just a month before, both of these being in the paper he wrote reviews for, the New York Tribune. Number 3. When Edgar Allan Poe published his compilation of poetry entitled The Raven and Other Poems, Matthew, as the secret reviewer for the New York Tribune, signing with his accustomed star, reviewed it. The star writer was rumored to be transcendentalist Margaret Fuller, the literary editor of the Tribune, but it was really Matthew writing all but a handful of these pieces, with a pseudonym he had used for many years and would use for various publications throughout his 50-year literary career. In that review, he makes several coded references to Poe's theft of the poem, for Poe personally, but also so that posterity would have the clues it needs to determine the correct author. He was constrained from publicly challenging Poe because he was involved in dangerous undercover anti-slavery work, including involvement with the Underground Railroad. But that didn't prevent him from putting us on notice that he was the real author. Remember that Matthew had shared The Raven, his deeply personal grief poem, with Poe in confidence, and had been betrayed in the worst possible way. He writes, "We have taken people at their word, and while rejoicing that women could bear neglect without feeling mean pique, and that authors, rising above self-love, could show candor about their works and magnanimously meet both justice and injustice, we have been rudely awakened from our dream and found that Chanticleer, who crowed so bravely, showed himself at last but a dunghill fowl." Chanticleer means a rooster, but this is specifically a reference to La Fontaine's Fables, a French version of Aesop's Fables rendered in verse, which Matthew had translated a few years earlier into English. He was the real author, but he permitted his friend, Elijah Wright, to publish them for him and to claim the role of translator. The fable which Matthew refers to here is only two stanzas long. It reads, "The Cock and the Pearl." A cock scratched up one day a pearl of purest ray, which to a jeweler he bore. "I think it fine," he said, "but yet a crumb of bread to me were worth a great deal more." So did a dunce inherit a manuscript of merit, which to a publisher he bore. "'Tis good," said he, "I'm told, yet any coin of gold to me were worth a great deal more." Note also that in the picture on the wall behind the three men, the rooster is in fact standing on a dunghill. This is just another indication that Matthew was specifically referring to this fable. Number 4. In the November 1846 edition of a New York humor magazine called Yankee Doodle, which Matthew was contributing to, there appeared his parody of The Raven about a bedbug he can't get rid of. He signed it E.A. Poe, where the word Poe, P-O-H, is an exclamation of distaste. He hinted that there is a lot more he would like to say when he prefaced the poem. The original is much longer, but these stanzas are respectfully submitted as specimens. It begins, "Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, lolling weary, over several curious books of sure-to-be-forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly sleeping, suddenly there came a creeping, as if some grimalkin peeping at an open pantry door. So, I said, 'Tis some mosquito, or some fly was here before, only this and nothing more. But full soon there came a burning that brought on uneasy turning, and again I felt the creeping somewhat stronger than before. Then I cried, "There's in the blanket something worse, and I don't thank it, for coming thus to prank it, and my quiet couch explore. For coming thus at midnight hour my calm couch to explore, 'tis a most confounded bore." A grimalkin is an elderly cat. Matthew frequently used that term and had also written about bedbugs and boars in his other works. There are more references in this poem which identify it as Matthew's writing, including one to the character Sam Slick, which was written in a similar style to his own Joshua Greening character in Yankee Doodle. Number 5. In the April 1846 edition of Graham's Magazine, Poe published an essay entitled The Philosophy of Composition, where he just happens to give, as an extended example, how he came to write The Raven. The gist of it is that it was merely an academic exercise, and he explains his intellectual decisions in choosing the various elements. Matthew must have been livid, and he finally responded to it in the December 5, 1846 edition of the Portland Transcript, which literary paper he knew Poe read, in such a way that Poe would be put on notice. This is the month following his bedbug parody on The Raven in Yankee Doodle. First, Matthew wrote a spin-off from his usual satiric character, Ethan Spike of Hornby, except that this time, and this time only, he featured another town called Libbyville. He had been submitting Ethan Spike exclusively to another paper, the Boston Chronotype. This way, he could publish a spin-off in the Transcript and still not violate his exclusivity agreement with the Chronotype. In this story, the little settlement of Libbyville has grown large enough to incorporate as a real town, but, like Poe, it gets puffed up with its own self-importance. Libbyville is situated down east, quite a smart stretch from Portland and about the same distance from Augusta, all in the sovereign state of Maine, Dirigio. It contains a tavern, store, and meetness, and a population of 103 beside the minister and town clerk. 11 rejoice in the name of Tarbox, 13 are Wigginses, the balance are Libbys. The town was incorporated and took rank among the independent towns of Maine by formal act of the legislature of 1834. But although several town meetings were held for the choice of selectmen, highway surveyors, and Hawgreaves, it was not until 38 that a regular representation to the general court was elected and took his seat in that august body. Then it was that a latent spirit of ambition and pride, which, in the language of Deacon Daniel Libby, had hitherto lain dormouse, began to manifest and to mightily exalt itself. Matthew had a habit of embedding secret messages in his work, sometimes by combining two different pieces one after the other or side by side. No one knew that he was the author of both of them, or, if he quoted someone else's work, that he had requested of the editor that it be placed there. In this instance, Matthew asked that a quote from Francis Quarles be placed directly below this humorous sketch of the town that got an inflated idea of its own importance. Matthew was specifically responding to a ridiculous comment made by Poe in his essay, which reads, "The next point to be considered was the mode of bringing together the lover and the raven, and the first branch of this consideration was the locale. For this, the most natural suggestion might seem to be a forest or the fields, but it has always appeared to me that a close circumscription of space is absolutely necessary to the effect of insulated incident. It has the force of a frame to a picture. It has an indisputable moral power in keeping concentrated the attention, and, of course, must not be confounded with mere unity of place. To Matthew, this was pure BS, which is why he appended a quote from Quarles to his Libbyville story. The complete Francis Quarles quote, which was misprinted in the transcript, reads, "Self-knowledge, as thou art a moral man, esteem not thyself as thou art, but as thou art esteemed. As thou art a Christian, esteem thyself as thou art, not as thou art esteemed. Thy pence in both rises and falls as the market goes. The market of a moral man is a wild opinion. The market of a Christian is a good conscience." Quarles. In other words, you may be a moral man, but you ain't no Christian. Which is to say, it was clear to Matthew that Poe, a flagrant liar, knew nothing about moral power whatsoever. Number 6. In 1849, not many months before Poe's death, Matthew seems to have once again been protesting his theft of the Raven in secret remarks encoded into his own published articles. In the March 3, 1849 edition of the Boston-based Flag of Our Union appeared a poem by Edgar Allan Poe entitled A Valentine. Poe bragged that he had embedded a prominent poet's name in that poem, in code, and challenged anyone to decipher it. It had earlier been read aloud at a Valentine's Day party in New York, and it had also been published in Sartain's Union magazine on February 15th, though Poe was supposedly unaware of the earlier printing. In any case, on the same date that it appeared in the Flag, Matthew responded with a solution in the Portland Transcript. There, he chided Poe that it was so easy it was, quote, hardly worth the ingenuity of the author of A Gold Bug. Matthew signed this response Polonius, a foolish, annoying character in Shakespeare's Hamlet. In the early 1840s, when he would have trustingly shared some of his unpublished work with Poe, he was writing under the pseudonym Poins, another Shakespearean character, this being a reference to his wild youth. If Matthew was hounding Poe in correspondence, Poe would have sarcastically turned Poins into Polonius, and Matthew would have signed this offhand solving of Poe's great coded poem as Polonius in defiance, so Poe would know who had done it. 3 weeks later, in the March 24, 1849 edition of the Transcript, appeared one of Francis Quarles' poems, which Matthew, who had long been personal friends with the editor, Charles Isley, must have requested for insertion. It is a clear message to Poe, which, in effect, says, "All right, you won't hear from me anymore, but you had better prepare to answer to your maker." The poem, titled simply Time in the Portland Transcript, reads, "Time's an hand's breadth, 'tis a tale, 'tis a vessel under sail, 'tis an eagle in its way, darting down upon its prey, 'tis an arrow in its flight, mocking the pursuing sight. 'Tis a short-lived, fading flower, 'tis a rainbow on a shower, 'tis a momentary ray smiling in a winter's day. 'Tis a torrent's rapid stream, 'tis a shadow, 'tis a dream, 'tis the closing watch of night dying at the rising light. 'Tis a bubble, 'tis a sigh. Be prepared, O man, to die." Francis Quarles, 1634. Poe died in October of that year, less than 7 months later. Number 7. In 1872, Benjamin Penhallow Shillaber, who was Matthew's friend, collaborator, and former editor in the early 1850s humor magazine, The Carpetbag, published a book called Partingtonian Patchwork. In it is a series called Blifkin's the Martyr, comprised of humorous stories based on Matthew's unfortunate second arranged marriage. In one anecdote, Blifkins tells Shillaber about a dream he had concerning the widow Thompson, in which they were together on a boat. Shillaber portrays him comically as drumming out the Hallelujah chorus on the chair and trying to telepathically communicate with the bust of Pallas which Blifkin says looks somewhat like the widow. All of this is disguised, so that instead of Abby, we have the Widow Thompson. But if you remove Shillaber's clownish satire and restore the account to its original version, you find that Matthew had had a visitation dream of Abby, his beloved first wife, with whom he tried to communicate telepathically. The bust of Pallas, also called Athena, the goddess of wisdom, a physical copy of which he must have owned, did in fact look somewhat like Abby, especially the bust that was retrieved from Herculaneum, the sister city of Pompeii. Both Matthew and Shillaber were believers in spiritualism, but Shillaber, perhaps, wasn't so strong a believer, and poked fun at his friend's efforts to re-establish contact with Abby. This, Shillaber had also done when he was editor of The Carpetbag. This simply tells us that Matthew did identify the bust of Pallas, the one taken from Herculaneum, with Abby, whose face was similar. That, in turn, means that the corresponding details in the Raven were not simply made up out of whole cloth, as Poe would have us believe. Rather, they were literal for Matthew, as was the setting, the book, and the other elements, all of which had a deep personal meaning for him. Shillaber's parody opens. "I never told you about my moonlight excursion last summer," said Blifkins, smiling, as he sat and gazed upon the bust of Pallas just above our study door. There was something provokingly funny in his look, and he drummed the hallelujah upon the chair, looking up at the bust aforesaid, as though he were exchanging private signals with the insensate plaster. If this weren't enough, Blifkins speaks of staring over the side of the boat at the images in the foam, something Matthew has written about more than once in travelogues. And he speaks of the story of Undine and the Naiads. There are several indications that Matthew used to think of Abby as a water sprite, so this is undoubtedly a veiled reference to her. There is even an ironic reference to the poem by Matthew's brother, Maud Muller, and its poignant line about what might have been. This is definitely Matthew, and he is definitely relating a visitation dream to Shillaber, his skeptical friend. That being the case, the reference to the bust of Pallas can only mean that he has also shared his authorship of this poem with Shillaber, who is likewise skeptical about that claim. Number 8. In the poem, Annabel Lee, published after Poe's death in 1849, are lines which read, "And this was the reason that long ago in this kingdom by the sea, a wind blew out of a cloud, chilling my beautiful Annabel Lee, so that her high-born kinsmen came and bore her away from me, to shut her up in a sepulchre in this kingdom by the sea." Matthew was also the author of this poem. He must have given Poe a copy of it at the same time he gave him a copy of The Raven in late 1842 or early 1843. But perhaps Matthew would have been able to prove his authorship of this one, and warned Poe not to try to publish it. Matthew would have drawn the line at this poem because the subject, Abby's death, was so deeply personal to him. Matthew's poetry was usually veiled autobiography. Many of the facts given in both of these poems were literally true for him. In this case, Matthew and Abby moved to Portland, Maine, by the sea, in late 1838. By 1840, she had developed consumption or tuberculosis, and she died on March 27, 1841. But a few days before her passing, her sisters came and took her back to her family home. Abby really was high-born. She came from French aristocracy, and her father was a marquis. Number 9. In the November 17, 1849 edition of the Boston Weekly Museum, Matthew, signing his letters to the editor as B, speaks of Poe's death and career. He mentions having seen him recite his poetry for an audience in Boston in 1845. Poe was supposed to have written a new poem for the occasion, but made the excuse that he hadn't had enough time, and instead read one he had published many years earlier called All a Rough. This poem was probably plagiarized from someone else, though Poe falsely claimed to have written it as a boy. Apparently, he was a very poor reader, as he cleared out 2/3 of the audience. At that time, he asked the management of the theater if he could read The Raven, which poem was so popular that the remainder of the people stayed. However, Matthew hints that Poe didn't read that one very well either. In fact, the way Matthew carefully words the account, it leaves open the possibility that Poe wasn't the author at all, though Matthew won't come right out and say it. He writes, "For many reasons, I consider that I was fortunate in hearing him recite his poem, Al-Araf, before the Boston Lyceum 4 years ago. Probably he was quite as unpopular in Boston as in any other city, and the circumstances attending his performance injured him, variously in the opinions of the Bostonians, more than anything he had previously done. 2/3 of his audience left before he closed, but with the most imperturbable sang-froid, he requested the presiding officer to announce to those still in the house that if they would remain, he would be pleased to recite to them The Raven. All was hushed at once, and Mr. Poe recited that remarkable poem in a manner that will never be repeated. Saying, quote, that remarkable poem instead of his remarkable poem means that Matthew himself was the author. Quote, in a manner that will never be repeated is code for a very poor recitation. He means that since Poe is dead, he will never recite it that way again. Number 10. In 1852, Matthew was contributing heavily, as always under several different pseudonyms or without any signature at all, to The Carpet Bag. One unsigned series he wrote utilized illustrations embedded in the text, as was done in the humor publications in England. The series included a country lady named Jerusha Prim, who had signed up for an art course which promised that she would paint like the masters in a matter of weeks. Another poked fun at the ugliness of the Bunker Hill Monument there in Boston. Yet a third has one Mr. Spoon preparing himself to go to California to dig for gold, but finally deciding he would be better off in the comfort of his own home. But in the December 18, 1852 edition, appeared another in the series, entitled The Vulture, an Ornithological Study. This is acknowledged to be one of the best parodies of The Raven ever written, and it was Matthew Franklin Whittier's work. Like many of his humorous sketches, it protested a boar who refused to leave. The reason it is so well written is that Matthew himself had written the original. This is the earliest publication of this poem, which historians seem to have completely missed while guessing about its author. The Vulture begins with Matthew's typical mischievous and slightly off-color humor. Once upon a midnight chilling, as I held my feet unwilling o'er a tub of scalding water at a heat of 94, nervously a toe in dipping, dripping, slipping, then out skipping, suddenly there came a ripping, whipping at my chamber's door. 'Tis the second floor, I muttered, flipping at my chamber's door, once a light and nothing more. Ah, distinctly I remember, it was in the chill November, and each cuticle and member was with influenza sore. Falteringly I stirred the gruel, steaming, creaming o'er the fuel, and anon removed the jewel that each frosted nostril bore, wiped away the trembling jewel that each reddened nostril bore, nameless here forevermore. And I recollect a certain draught that fanned the window curtain, chilled me, filled me with a horror of 2 steps across the floor, and besides I'd got my feet in, and a most refreshing heat in. To myself I sat repeating, if I answer to the door, rise to let the ruffian in who seems to want to burst the door, I'll be that and something more. The poem concludes, Smith, I shrieked, the accent humbler dropping, as another tumbler I beheld him mix, be off, you drive me mad, it's striking 4. Leave the house and something in it. If you go on at the gin, it won't hold out another minute. Leave the house and shut the door. Take your beak from out my gin and take your body through the door. Quote the vulture, nevermore. And the vulture never flitting, still is sitting, gulping down my stout by gallons and my oysters by the score. And the beast, with no more breeding than a heathen savage feeding, the new carpet's tints unheeding, throws his shells upon the floor. and his smoke from out my curtains, and his stains from out my floor, shall be sifted nevermore." Compare this with a humorous account that Matthew wrote 2 years earlier for the Boston Weekly Museum, signing as his travelogue personality, Quails. "Leave the room, sir. Leave the room instantly, or the consequences be upon your own head. Not another word, not a word. Don't you open your mouth, but leave the room instantly." Snatching up his hat and looking as if he had received an unexpected shock from a galvanic battery or been nearly skinned alive by a flash of lightning, Mr. Digits slid out of the room at a pace that would have put Morse's new telegraph to the blush. We regret very much losing our temper on the above occasion, and hoping that this number of the museum may happen to fall under the observation of our dear friend Digits, we will now apologize for so doing, offering, at the same time, a bit of advice for his consideration, viz., always knock before entering the room of a stranger, never seat yourself until you have been invited to do so, and never, under any consideration, use a handsome parlor stove as a spittoon. Quails, which is very similar to Quarles, was a pen name Matthew adopted for this paper in 1849. It was falsely claimed for an entertainer named Ossian Dodge. As with the claim that Margaret Fuller wrote the star-signed reviews in the New York Tribune, Matthew broadly hinted that he was the real author, but never openly challenged the mistake, as he was still doing dangerous anti-slavery work at the time and needed to remain undercover.